even though they die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall live eternally. Let us continue our worship this morning with our opening hymn, which is Come, Ye Thankful People, Come.
Destroyed,
Yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I, and not another, how my heart yearns within me. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please read responsibly along with me, with the congregation reading the bolded verses from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our second lesson for this morning is taken from the prophecy of Revelation, which talks about God's kingdom, talks about heaven. So a reading from Revelation, the 7th chapter. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne, and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they, and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them through springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel for this morning is according to St. John, the 1st chapter. Glory to you, Lord. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Would you please rise if you're able as we sing How Great Thou Art. Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God the Father, and from our Lord, and from our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. We are gathered today to say goodbye to a really wonderful man. He was family for some of us, a friend for some of us. He was a farmer. I'd consider Alan one of those salt of the earth type people. You know those farmers. I grew up on a farm, and so there's just something about farmers that know how to work hard, that really have to trust God to bring those timely rains to grow your corn or your soybeans and to provide for you. Alan was a farmer for a long time. 1965, he and his wife, Darlene, moved to the home place where they lived and they raised a family. They had hogs for many years, transitioned into cattle, crops, corn, soybeans, wheat, milo, you named it. Alan was a farmer. As I understand it, he was officially supposed to retire at the age of 65. But you know, farmers, when they retire, they don't really retire. So Alan, even though he was officially retired, he was still helping out all the time on the farm. Driving the tractors, disking, and helping feed the cattle. He loved to be out there, loved helping Mark, just loved being a farmer. I really enjoyed getting to know Alan. I was blessed to come here this summer. Unfortunately, the only visits that I got to have with Alan were those window visits. When I'd visit him at the care center, we'd open his window and he'd be inside and I would be outside. And truth be told, I didn't know how those were going to go. You know, I'm used to visiting with people sitting in the same room, me sitting in one chair, they sitting in their own chair, reading scripture and really being close with each other. But those window visits that I got to enjoy with Alan were great. We had some great conversations. He loved the Lord. He loved you three. He really cherished you three. He loved this church. He loved this life. He loved talking about what was going on in the community and the farm and everything else like that. He really, really loved this life. Alan was the oldest son of Joe and Ann. He grew up in Schuyler, born in 1934. In 1934, our world and our state was in the midst of the Great Depression. Can you imagine that? Growing up, being born in the middle of the Great Depression. I think a child, anybody who was born in those times, learns a certain hardiness, learns that you have to roll your sleeves up, you've got to really work hard in this life to make a good and honest living. Born in the middle of the Great Depression. As I understand it, he learned pretty early how to help out his dad on the farm, and his dad very quickly put him to good use. One year, he met the love of his life, who was named Darlene. They were married over 40 years. So I understand that they were very thankful to be able to celebrate that 40 years. Darlene passed away in 2003. The love of his life, though, 40 years together. One of the things that they love to do, which is unusual for us men to love to do, but good for Alan, and I'm sure great for the marriage, he loved to dance. He loved to square dance. He loved spending time with his wife. And I was told they would go dancing all the time, sometimes multiple times a week, just going dancing and enjoying this life that God had given them. Now I'm convinced that Alan is dancing today with Darlene. And he'd been waiting 17 years to see the love of his life once again. And I'm convinced that they're dancing in heaven. Square dancing or whatever it might be, whatever type of dance they're doing up in heaven, I am convinced that those two are reunited. And that's something to celebrate. That all those people that have gone before him, his friends, his family, his wife, He's with once again. And even though we miss him, and we do miss him, we'll miss him in this life, we should celebrate that he is reunited with so many people who have gone before him. As Alan and Darlene were married, they had these three wonderful children, Rita, Mark, and Beth. And it was the farm life. The kids told me that they learned from a very young age how to learn to drive a tractor. That's a good life, right? Growing up on the farm, learning to drive the tractor. And they learned from a very young age how to help out on the farm. You know, most kids never ever learn how to drive a tractor and should learn that from the very youngest age. That is a very good thing. Sunday, faith was very important for Alan. As I understand, it didn't matter how late you stayed up on Saturday night, whatever you were doing on the weekend, you were right here on Sunday morning. And Alan loved to come to the early service, and so they were here worshiping their God, hearing God's word. Alan loved those good classic hymns as well, being fed by God's word, coming here to celebrate the Lord with his fellow Christians. The readings I selected for this morning. Our first lesson from the book of Job, it's very short, it's very sweet. It is only 3 verses long, but I selected it for a very specific reason. Job, who's an Old Testament prophet, Old Testament character, lived long, long before Jesus Christ came into this world. We're not exactly sure when Job lived, but our best understanding was he was somewhat of a contemporary of Moses. We think he probably lived around the year 2200 BC. So more than 2,000 years before Jesus Christ came into this world. Scripture tells us he comes from the land of Ur, U-R, which we're not exactly sure where that is, but this Job, towards the end of his book, he talks about knowing that his Redeemer lives. 2,000 years before Jesus came into this world, he talks about knowing his Redeemer. He talks about knowing the Lord, and he makes this profound statement. Somehow, some way, God had given him a glimpse of what God was planning. Somehow, Job knew that even though he would die, even though his body would be laid in the ground, that he would see the Lord face to face with his own eyes, with his own body, 2,000 years before Jesus came. The gospel message that I picked for this morning talks about light. And it's from the very beginning of the book of John. Talks about how Jesus Christ is the light of this world. As we are getting closer to Christmas, we know that our days, every day we get a little bit more darkness that comes with our days, right? The sun comes up a little bit later every morning and sets a little bit sooner. We've got less and less daylight. Before Jesus Christ came into this world, we as human beings really didn't have hope. We didn't really know what God's plan was. Sure, God gave Job a little glimpse of that light that was to come into this world. But before Jesus Christ came into this world, before God sent the light from heaven into our world, we were hopeless. We had no hope because we were sinners. We were a lost cause. God sent that light into this world, the true light, to show us the way, to guide us forward, to give us hope, to know that even though we will die on this earth, even though we're a lost cause, God loves us, and God sent that light into this world to be our salvation, to be our hope. Now, 2020, I don't know if any of us know what true darkness is. You know, even when we turn all the lights off in the middle of the night, picture yourself in your home. You've got every single light off that you can think of. Even when we do that, we've got different lights in the corner. Maybe an alarm clock, or maybe a cell phone that's being charged, or maybe a light on the oven, or the street light outside. Even when we think we're in complete and utter darkness, there's always a little bit of light. But back in Jesus' time, they knew what true darkness was. They didn't have these artificial lights. I've experienced true darkness once in my life. It was in Pennsylvania in a cave. And if you've ever been down at the bottom of a cave, you know that's probably one of the only places in the world that you can today experience true and utter darkness. This cave is called Laurel Caverns in southwest Pennsylvania. You go 600 feet underground. And the whole path, it's lighted up on your way down, but towards the end of it, they turn off all the lights. And everybody's cell phone is turned off, and it's nothing but pitch black. That's what the world was like before Jesus Christ came into this world. Thanks be to God that he sent the true light, the Word of God, Jesus Christ, born in Bethlehem, who lived this life, who lived it perfectly, who shows us the way. Thanks be to God that Alan knew that light, followed that light, trusted that light, was baptized and was a believer and committed his life to that light. And so we rejoice, knowing that even though Alan is gone, he is with that light, Jesus Christ in heaven. We rejoice knowing that Alan is fully experiencing that light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for giving us Alan, a friend, a father, a husband, a wonderful man to know. But more than anything else, thank you, Lord, for bringing him home. Amen. Our service continues this morning, and would you please confess with me the Christian faith that we hold in common using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Would you please rise if you're able as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please remain standing as we sing our closing hymn, which is Praise and Thanksgiving. we close. Let us end with our commendation. Let us commend Alan to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. And to your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Alan J. Judah. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in hope and in peace. In the name of Christ, amen.